say that it's a... We'll sort you out at the end of the interview. Okay, okay, we'll do it then. I don't deal with money. We'll... Oh, Erica, if you go and see Erica just now. Here, Erica, you may as well take this then and do that. Right. There you go, go see her now and be great. You don't often get to say or introduce a legend, but the word legend is overused. This guy is a proper legend, and certainly from my childhood and people who are my age, about 32. what? Would you please give a big warm welcome to Peter Purves! Of your work, so you can just sit down and enjoy that. How does that feel watching that?
Weird.
Yeah.
Obviously, I've seen the bits of me that exist in there quite a lot, and so I am used to it. But no, it's always quite strange to see. And there are a few shots in there, you think, oh, yeah, that happened. Yeah, I remember that. The saddest thing are the things that are missing. I mean, there's such good stuff missing. Funnily enough, I've just recorded a BBC audio book of the massacre. But it's the original John Lograti book, and it's very different from what went out on television. If you've seen the, if you've listened to the original audio recordings, it's a very different story. It's the same story, but it's told in a very different way, which is fascinating. But it's a very nice thing. I only got it 2 days ago. They sent me a copy, so I guess it's out now. And I listened to it on the way up here. That's very arrogant, isn't it? You sit there listening to yourself on a four-hour drive from Suffolk. But I was very pleased with it. It worked extraordinarily well. And I saw them listening to it, I was saying, oh, I wish we'd done that bit, you know? There were certain parts in it which I thought were, certainly different. I don't think they were better. I think Donald Tosh created something marvellous with the script that we eventually did record. But anyway, good. Hi, Charlie.
I always think when I watch a lot of 60s Doctor Who, and I don't know if you agree with me, but I always think that some 60s Doctor Who actually looks fresher than some early 70s Doctor Who. It still looks... It looks cleaner and more modern. It doesn't seem to have dated as much as some even 70s colour Who. Do you find that when you occasionally watch them, that, compared to other 60s TV?
Yeah, I mean, the quality of most of the things has been so poor until recently when they've digitally cleaned them up and they're now issuing DVDs. The Ark, I always thought was terrible. I had that on VHS, and I mean, it was almost unwatchable. The quality was so bad, 405 lines, and you know... That's what they transmitted, that's what it was. But I've seen the cleaned up DVD version, and my word, it looks good. I'm not saying it was a great story, because I think it was a great story, but it was so badly executed, not by the actors, but unfortunately the director didn't have the money. Derek Martin, no, it wasn't Derek Martin, it was Michael Imerson, yeah, thank you. And he just didn't have the money, and then sadly on the day of the final recording of the final episode, John Wiles walked into the control gallery at, I think we're at Riverside, and told him he was fired. And that was it. And he never worked for the BBC again, which is rather savage and rather nasty. He still had a recording to do and he didn't have a job anymore. He lives quite close to me in Suffolk, and he told me that story about 5 years ago. I was absolutely astonished. But that was the BBC.
Welcome to the BBC. You were part of the first major cast change in the show. It had a fairly established cast up to that point with William Russell and Jacqueline Wright, and it obviously that was incredibly popular. Did you feel a sense of pressure when you took over? Did you feel stepping in, I don't want to be the guy that screws this up, sort of, you know, feeling?
No, I was totally in awe. When I played Morton Dill, that one episode in The Chase, it was, you know, it was a one-off. I wasn't expecting anything to come of it. It was not a character who was going to go on. And I walked into the rehearsal situation, and there were people that I, you know, Russ, who'd been in Ivanhoe, was it? Not Ivanhoe, Sir Lancelot, was it?
Yeah.
I can't remember now, it's such a long time ago, but one of those wonderful series that were on, film series at that time, and Jackie, who I knew, Jackie Hill, and there was William Hartnell, who not only was Doctor Who, but I'd seen him in so many films. He made 70 films, this guy, isn't it? And you walk into a rehearsal room and you've got 1 week. You go in on the Monday, well, you haven't got a week because you do it on the Friday, so you walk in on the Monday and you've just got to get on with it. And I got on extremely well with them. So it was just, you know, it was just a job. And it was a job where I had to do my best, where I was very impressed with everyone who was around me. You know, they were names, they were important. And to be offered the job the evening after we recorded the episode, which is how it happened, I was asked to go over to the pub. And after we'd done the recording, and Verity Lambert came up and said, we don't know how you feel about this, but you know Russ and Jackie are leaving. They're leaving in 3 weeks. Would you be interested in taking over? What? You know, is this happening? Is this real? They just bought me a pint and they're offering me a job. Following day, I signed the contract. I mean, it was absolutely amazing. Then the nerves kicked in. Then I started getting worried. I wasn't nervous playing Morton Dill. I was enjoying myself because he was such a goof, you know. He was fun to play. And I got on really well with people. And it's extremely recently, I'd say within the past 18 months, that I discovered from Maureen O'Brien what actually happened. Bill was, he was very nervous about working with people he didn't know. And he was horrified that Jackie and Russ had decided to leave. I mean, he already had the one thing of Caroline Ford going and Maureen coming, but he hit it off with Maureen and loved her, and that was great. But Jackie and Russ he'd worked with for something like, I think he'd done 80 episodes. So, you know, that's 2 years' work. And he thought of them as a family, and he just saw the show collapsing around him. They hadn't found anybody. I mean, I played Morton Dill. We did these things in real time, a week at a time. I'm in episode 3 as Morton Dill, and episode 6 was when Jackie and Russ actually left the show, and they still haven't cast anybody. So they were in a bit of a panic. I got on so well with Bill and Maureen and Jackie and Russ and the rehearsals. On the Wednesday, Maureen went up to Bill, who she said was in quite a nervous state. You know, he was quite neurotic about the fact that, you know, he didn't know what was going to happen with the show, and it was his show, and he created it, and all the rest of it. And she went up and she said, "Look, Bill, I know you're worried, but what about this guy?" And she said it was like a weight came off his shoulder, because I'd got on very well with him. He chatted to me an awful lot, and he'd give me a few acting tips. You know, he'd sort of take me under his wing, and we enjoyed the scene, silly scene that we played together. And she said it was like a weight came off his, and he went, "Oh yeah." Apparently they both then went to Verity, and we had the producer's run through on the Thursday, the following day. She took a good look at me during, Verity took a very good look at me during the rehearsals. I wasn't aware of it, but this is what happened. And then we did the recording, and I didn't let them down on the recording, and the end result was quite amusing. And she took me to one side and said, would you be interested in taking over? And I mean, that's how it happened. For me, absolutely fascinating. I thought Verity had just come into the rehearsal, seen me and thought, oh, we haven't got anybody, I wonder if this guy will do. It wasn't quite like that. And in fact, it was much more flattering than that. So I was quite chuffed. So that's what happened. So in answer to your question, Charlie, I wasn't in awe until after I got the job. And then I thought, bloody hell, now I've got something to fill in, you know, because until then, I was doing a short acting job, put the money in the bank, let's hope there's another one round the corner. Suddenly I've got a television series. Wow, you know.
Baby, before I move on, I am aware I said Jacqueline Wright, and I meant Jacqueline Hill, who played Barbara Wright, because I know what you're like. You'll be on Twitter saying, interviewer doesn't noise. It's a long day.
You notice I didn't pick you up on
that. I've been catching up with William Hartnell's other stuff recently. There's a great film called Hell Drivers that he did, and he's great in that. Brian Rock, he's great in that. Even Carry On Sergeant, he's brilliant in that. He brings a real touch of pathos to it. He was a much more diverse actor than he's given credit for, I think.
I think he was a terrific actor. I mean, in fact, if you look at The Supporting Life, which is the job that really got him the part of Doctor Who, actually, I mean, his accent's terrible. I mean, he could have done that better, but the performance, the character, was just totally absorbing and real, and you felt for this strange hanger-on at the rugby club. Great stuff, and that's what got him the job. And I mean, he was desperate to have the job. And I mean, nothing hurt Bill more than losing the job. You know, he created it, and I think he felt he was indispensable. And why wouldn't you? You know, you create the iconic figure, and the show goes on for 4 years, and then suddenly you're removed. But by that time, he was ill, and he really couldn't remember his lines. I don't know if you saw the clip of the interview he did for, I think it was BBC West Country, I don't know, from Bristol. I think it's been shown, probably most Doctor Who fans have seen this in some form, when he was doing a pantomime. And my God, the bitterness was coming through there. And he felt, I really felt for him, because he was a strange man, he was difficult. There were lots of things not to like about Bill, but in my experience, I only got to see most of the things that you would like about him. Occasionally, he overstepped the mark, and you know, have to look away rather than laugh in his face. But he was a very sensitive man, and as I say, I think he was heartbroken when the show was taken away from him. But he wasn't really capable of carrying on, and they tried several ways of trying to write him down in the series. The massacre being one of them. I took 2 weeks off during that, but. The Celestial Toy Maker, when literally they wanted to see if the show would work without him, and as it happens, it did. I think there's one episode of Celestial Toy Maker that exists only. It was a good series, and I think things like The Crystal Maze came out of that. I mean, I don't think they were the kind, you know, that's what we did in 4 episodes of Doctor Who. And of course there was a clip there of me with Peter, the guy who played the Billy Bunter character, Peter Stevens. No, it isn't Peter Clays. I can't remember anyway, the Billy Bunting character. He played several of the other characters during this, and Carmen Silveira was the woman who played him there. But it was a very clever idea, giving us these games to play, which, if we get them wrong, are fatal to us. Not only to us, but also to Bill. And he's playing the Trilogic game, which is fatal to him and the universe, I believe, if he fails with that. Of course he didn't. How could he? Even I could do that by the end of it. several attempts. He only had one attempt, and he had to work it out as he went along, supposedly. I don't think Bill played. I don't think Bill understood it, to be quite honest. But as it was only his hand that played it for most of the serial, it didn't really matter because they wrote him out apart from his hands and filled those bits of healing.
Yeah. I want to segue kind of from Carry On Sergeant. One of my favourite stories is the Time Meddler. I think it's a fantastic story. And Peter Butterworth, of course, is the meddling monk. Very talented actor and very talented comedy actor, Peter Butterworth, who brought something special to that episode, I think, that story.
Well, I mean, so much so, that's why he came back in the Dalek Master Plan. I mean, he was he was a very funny comedy actor, as was Bill, and of course they've worked together in numerous bits of film and television as well prior to that. But Peter Butterworth was lovely. He was a delight to work with. I mean, Maureen and I loved working with him, and later Gina Marshall and I loved working with him. I think there were two episodes of The Master Plan that Peter Butterworth was in. And he plays such a silly character. I mean, it's really absurd. It's quite interesting that I think I've done a couple of Big Finish stories which take place during the Dalek Master Plan. They're between episodes and episodes and they work quite well, but they're involved with the monks and bits that I'm sneaky, but we had the monk in one of them, and that was Graham Garden played it in a recent one. They merge into one, and it's embarrassing that they do, because I have to write things down if I'm going to remember them. I can't even go to the shop for a bottle of wine and come back with the right stuff. Sorry, the memory's going. I'm getting like Bill Hartnell, I think, which is a trifle worrying. But no, I mean, things do merge into one. But I mean, Peter Butterworth was a lot of fun to be around. I mean, just a delightful man. He was great company, as I must say was Bill Hartnell. I mean, go out for a lunch with him, and you have a really good time. Conversational, chatty, friendly. He was wonderful in that respect. And it's very sad that, I mean, certain people will dismiss him out of hand. Not as a bad actor, but as a bad person. Not true. He was mixed like all of us are. And I always find it rather sad when people malign him.
The Gunfighters. Right, I don't think The Gunfighters is that bad. I quite enjoyed it when I watched it, actually. I think it's a lot of fun.
Hey, wait a minute, I don't think it's that bad either. I was playing Roy Rogers, yeah. I thought it was fantastic.
I think The Gunfight is actually amazing. I think it's really well shot. It's really quite exciting.
Believe it or not, we did that in Riverside Studios, which I swear, if they were a couple of feet taller than this, you've been to Riverside. You did a film with me at Riverside, didn't you?
Yeah.
Did we do a thing about the old studio? I swear it's not more than about 2 or 3 feet taller than this. So the wide shots, which look like bits of film, I think Rex Tucker did a job and a half on the production. I didn't get on with Rex. I mean, he paid no attention to me at all. I was, everything that happens in there that works or doesn't work is my own fault. He paid no attention to me. He was only interested in the guys he cast, who were the baddies, and not the regulars. He didn't pay us much attention at all. But his filming work was stunning. I don't know if you've at any of these events you've met people like Tristan de Vere Cole, who was Rex Tucker's assistant. Who, I mean, he raves about some of the shots, because they were impossible to get virtually. Can you imagine getting a wide shot? Some of them, as long as this room, without seeing the lights in the ceiling, yet making it look like a whole chunk of Dodge City. I mean, absolutely amazing. Next time you look at it, admire that, because the filmic quality of it is absolutely stunning. I mean, I think the song's crap. However,
I was about to ask for the song. That's where I was going, actually.
However, it wouldn't have been if it hadn't been used as the bridge. In every scene, it just gets so tedious going on. And I mean, Linda Barron sang it very, very nicely and all the rest of it, but it was used as that bridge and it just made it awful. And I didn't sing it very well. It wasn't in a key that I was comfortable with anyway. And I mean, I used to be a singer. I was a trained singer. So I could actually sing, not though you know it from that. And but I going back to your very start, but you said I didn't think it was all that bad. Neither did I. I think it's a cracking story. It works extremely sensibly. It fits in with Doctor Who. It was all the things that Doctor Who should be. And I mean, we never in any of those places that we went to, we were always involved in the history of the thing and telling the story. Whether this was a real story or not, or a fictional story, I'm not particularly sure. I don't know how much of Dodge City and the Clanton brothers and all that were real. I think to a certain extent they did exist. I think they were real characters all, but I don't think it happened as was suggested. I mean, that's Hollywood and all the rest. But I think Rex managed a Hollywood-esque version of it. I thought that really worked.
It's
what I like the fact that the Doctor is never really allowed to take over. He's kind of bundled through the whole thing. We're used to the stories where the Doctor charges in and takes over the situation, but in this he's kind of out of control and not really. This is quite comic and it works really well.
And if you remember, at the end of the previous episode, he bites on the sweet and wrecks his tooth. Yeah. So that's why he had to go to the dentist when we got in there. And of course, everything happened around him. So he was incidental to the plot. He was necessary to the plot because they had to mistake him for Doc Holliday, which was great. But I mean, it's a nonsense piece. But my word, what fun nonsense! I thought it was good.
Cool if your teeth could just regenerate in the break. No, just your teeth, just new one there. Okay, well, obviously you've done way more than Doctor Who, and I'd like to talk about Blue Peter. How did Blue Peter come about? And how did you make the transition from actor to TV presenter?
It was forced upon me, really. I had no intention of becoming a television presenter. That was not in my mind. I didn't want to be one. I wanted to be an actor. I wanted to make movies. I wanted all sorts of things. And I suppose the only regret I've had about my career is I've never made a movie. Not a proper one. I've made lots of films, but I've never made a movie. I was on the point of giving up the business. I left Doctor Who, not by my own choice. Innes Lloyd decided that the companions would go, and I went, and Dodo went shortly afterwards, and then Bill went. I mean, you know, it was the night of the long knives at the BBC, blood everywhere. And I left that, and unlike today, if you do a television series, you know, I did 46 episodes of a show, then you're absolutely made for life today. In those days, you were made for 46 weeks, because that's all they paid you. And one little thing that's worth pointing out now, I get residuals now for the new DVDs of The Ark, which far exceed, it's not huge, please, believe me, but they far exceed the entire fees I received whilst I was doing the series. Way, by a mile. And we're talking hundreds, not thousands here. I mean, there's not a lot of money from back in the old days. They paid us very little, and the BBC never truly remunerated us, which is, I think, is very sad. But that's the way it happens. I mean, I was at school with people like Jimmy Armfield, you know, and he was a wonderful footballer. You may have heard him on Radio 5 recently, but he was a great player. He was an England captain as well. And I mean, he's not a rich man, and he had the greatest. He was one of the greatest players we had, the England captain for about 5 years. Anyway, I digress. What was the question again?
I forgot. How did you become? How did you go from actor to TV presenter?
Well, I had, unlike today, when you would go from a television series straight into either a West End play or whatever, it just didn't happen. There were no offers coming through the letterbox, and I was struggling to find work. Well, 18 months of struggling to find work really takes its toll on you. And you reach a point where you think, I'm never going to really make a go of this. You go for auditions, you got nothing. Then you get one job. I did a few episodes of things like Zed Cars and various bits, but there was nothing, basically. And I was on the point of giving up the business. I mean, I really was. I've got to go and do something else. I've got teaching qualifications. Maybe I'll go back and teach for a while. And I was seriously considering that. And to cap it all, I got a letter from my then agent who said, look, Pete, we've been trying for 18 months to get something moving forward. We really don't really think it's working. We think you'd be better off with a different agent. Let them try a new tack, which just sent me down through the floor. You go, oh my God, yeah, that's yet another thing. The following morning, I got a phone call from those agents saying, look, we know you received the letter yesterday. I must fill in something which you may have heard before. I had the Trilogic game from the Celestial Toymaker, which I'd taken home after the event. It was this lovely pyramid in 10 pieces, and that's how you played the game from the Celestial Toymaker, moving these pieces and moving the pyramid from one spot to another of three. And I decided that this was an unlucky thing to have. At that time in the 60s, pyramids had this sort of mystic thing. There was a whole thing about if you put a razor blade in a small pyramid, it would stay sharp forever. And surprisingly, they did seem to. Try it now, may still do the same thing. Anyway, that's beside the point. There was some sort of mystic spiritual nonsense going around at the time that suggested that this was bringing me bad luck. And so when I got that letter, that was the last straw, and I took it downstairs, two flights down to the basement in the block of flats where I lived in Cornwall Gardens in London, and shoved it in the big bin and went back upstairs. Following day, I got a phone call from the agents who had virtually sacked me the previous day and said, look, we know you've got the letter, we're not going to handle this, but we had a phone call from a programme called Blue Peter. They'd like to see you. No, I'd never written to them. If you're interested, here's the phone number. So I thought, well, might as well. I knew what the show was. I'd seen it. Funnily enough, John Noakes, who had been at drama school with my first wife, we'd seen the episode of Blue Peter one afternoon sitting at home when he came on for the first time. He said, bloody hell, that's John Noakes. Drama school, no. So I knew, I'd seen the show a few times. In fact, I saw the very first few episodes with Chris Tracy, later with Valerie Singleton, seen all that. So I knew what the show was. I thought, well, it's not really me, but all right. I rang them up. Yes, we'd love to see you. Went to see them, had a very nice interview. They sent me away. Then they asked me if I'd go in and see them again. I went about a week later and saw them again. Saw Biddy Baxter, Edward Barnes, and Rosemary Gill, who were the triumvirate who ran the show. And they sent me away that time and said, look, we're going to send you a script and then we'll ask you to come and audition in the studio. And a script arrived on a Wednesday evening, on a Thursday evening, and I was to go in on the Friday and actually do the audition. I'd never seen the script before, and oh my God, well, that actually was the same pressure that the show had eventually. But there was a script of a 15-minute programme, which was mostly me. There was a girl in this as well, it turned out to be Valerie Singleton, so I went in, oh my God, meeting Valerie Singleton. I went in and I'd learnt it and I did the audition. As I came out in my audition, I saw Michael Aspel going in. I thought, well, that's buggered that, I'm not going to get that job. I went, they thanked me very much, and I went home. They called me in about 5 days later for another interview, so I went in for an interview. They chatted to me for about 5 minutes, 10 minutes, and said, thanks very much, Peter. And fine, okay, so I walked out, went to the lift, fifth floor of the East Tower in Television Centre. I'm waiting for the lift, and suddenly the office door opened, and Rosemary Gill, one of the producers, came running out and said, Peter, would you come back? And so they took me back in and said, look, we think we'd like to offer you the job. So that's how it happened. What had happened in the background was, I used to be an actor in repertory in Barrow-in-Furness, and there's a young man, just married, down in London, no money, wearing out a lot of shoe leather, going to trying to get agents to take me on. I'd been a teacher for a year, so I was fully qualified as a teacher. I'd jacked it in, thrown the job in, tried to become an actor, got nowhere, nothing happening. And I got a telegram. Do you remember telegrams? I got a telegram saying, if you're interested, there's a job here. And that was in Barrow-in-Furness, which was where I had worked. I'd done two plays in my school summer holidays there. I'd gone for an audition, been cast in a couple of plays, and I'd done those and been paid £5 a week for the privilege. And so this is now 3 years later. I'm now a fully qualified teacher. I'm trying to get acting work. I don't have to have an equity card. Gold dust, a job offered. So I went back to Barrow. I worked there for 2 years. Went back to London, got a young son on the way, beginning to panic, got a little bit of work in London, that's all going on. Went back home and went down to the theatre. The people who used to run the theatre had moved on. There was a new chap there called Giles Havergal running it. And he met me and we talked and he said, if you want to do a play, you can always come up here and do a play. That's lovely. Thank you very much, Giles. We had a nice chat. Forgot about all that. He had been having dinner with a lady whose job it was at the National Theatre to reply to actors who were looking for work and trying to get work at the National Theatre. If there wasn't any work for them, she wrote back to them. I'd never written to her. She'd had dinner about 3 days prior with Edward Barnes, one of the three people at the BBC on Doctor Who. And he'd said, we're looking for someone to replace Christopher Trace. Do you know anybody? And she hadn't got anyone on her books that she would suggest. But she said, I'll think about it. 3 days later, she's having dinner and Giles Havergal is one of her friends, one of her guests at the table. And she happened to bring up the subject. And he said, I know someone who could do that really well. And he named me. That's why they phoned me. Talk about the small world. But that's that, you know more about the story than I do, because I couldn't repeat any of that. There we go. So,
And one of the things I loved about Doctor about Blue Peter in the 70s was it was always incredibly loyal to Doctor Who. It always had a Doctor Who promotional segment on it. Did they always come to you purposely because you'd been in the show to do the Doctor Who segments? Because you did most of them.
Yeah, I think they did. I did the interviews with John Pertwee when he came in with Bessie and when he came in with his with the Who-mobile and stuff like that. I think Johnny noticed quite a few things. We did one sort of make thing where we made stuff for a toy theatre, which was all Doctor Who related.
Which I made. That's the only thing I ever made was on Blue Peter. I did that and it was crap.
You should have seen it in the studio. That was crap. So, it's one of the reasons they never asked me to make
it. I know, but you can't be so
bad at it. I was really bad at making these things. But anyway, yeah. Yes, I think they did.
Yeah.
I mean, it was a nice tie-in. And it was worth remembering. It was nice that they remembered that. I always hoped that somewhere along the line, you know, some acting agents would decide, oh yeah, there's a guy we could try him. And no acting work ever came my way apart from pantomime after I finished Blue Peter. Once you get become seriously typecast as, well, I was typecast as me. I mean, nowadays it doesn't seem to matter as much. Though I don't know whether you feel, when you're watching stuff on television, you see somebody who you know from a different genre, and does it rub the wrong way? Do you go, oh, that doesn't work? I don't know. But I mean, that's always the excuse that's given for not giving a face a job in an area that they're not expected to be in. I still hope it'll happen. But at my age, it's probably not going to.
Well, you were in Blue Peter in an era when it did. It was an iconic time for the show. I mean, everyone talked about it, and in a way that people wouldn't talk about Blue Peter now, it pervaded society across the way. People did impressions of John, the Val's old knickers line, stuff like that, you know, which became a part of the cultural sort of iconography.
Yeah, and it continued for quite a while like that, but it started to lose that element. Once we got digital television, once Channel 4 started, then Sky started, then we started getting multiple channels, and kids had the option of not watching Blue Peter. In those days, there was only a spot of about an hour and a half when kids got children's television. And there were great programs. There were some really nice, wonderful programs there. You know, things like Vision On, and for little kids, things like Play School, but they all fitted into this tiny children's program slot, of which Blue Peter was part. And once you got more channels and more opportunity to watch something else, then the audience started to drift away. I mean, when we were doing the show, the audience was 8.5 million in the winter, and that was average, and it was 5.5 million in the summer. And that's at, you know, 5 past 5 in the afternoon. I mean, phenomenal audiences. There's so many programs on television would kill to get figures, anything approaching our worst figures on those. But of course it died away. And I mean, sadly, Blue Peter currently is picking up an audience in the region of 100,000 or less. I mean, that's the difference. That's very sad. However, it doesn't seem to have lost its iconic name. That seems to still sit up there and people still respond to it. But the number of people who watch it, certainly when it's going out live, are very, very few. And of course, as people can record shows all over the time, you don't know how many people it's picking up in addition. But it's a small audience now, but so is everything. The days when Coronation Street and EastEnders would get 16 million, well, you know, they're getting 9 and 10 now. It does change, and that's how the whole business has changed.
I wonder what the ratings happened to the ratings in the episode where John Knowles showed us all his arse, which those of you who remember that, John had a big bruise doing a bobsleigh.
Well, that's right, he
dropped it. Well, it was 70s BBC, I mean, we should be surprised now. But
he came off the bobsleigh in the Cresta run, and yeah, it was a hell of a bruise. What it didn't own up to at the time was, as he was about to show it, he realised, don't take this the wrong way, because he's very straight, this Johnny, but he was wearing his wife's knickers. So, there you go.
I'll hand the open out to the floor. Does anyone have any questions they'd like to ask Peter? Oh, hands shooting up, yes. gentleman with glasses and then the gentleman next to him.
Hello, Peter. One of the delights of your Big Finish stories is your interpretation of William Hartnell's first Doctor. I wondered how easy was that to find? Did that take a bit of dig?
Thank you. Bless your heart. That's very kind. A lot of people have commented on it. I don't really think it's accurate as a... You know, I'm not John Culshaw, I'm not Rory Bremner, so it's not that accurate. But what I was trying to do was to find an impression of the guy as he performed. And if you were in the recording booth watching me when I'm recording those, I'm doing Bill's hand gestures at the same time. You know, there's a microphone hanging up here in front of me. And I try to play Bill Hartnell. That's how I get into it. It works. And it's consistent. Funnily enough, I was just saying to one of your friends out here before that the massacre that I've just read, the first two or three times it's the Doctor's voice, I'm not happy with. I could have done that slightly better. By the time I'm into chapter two and chapter three, I'm perfectly content. So it works then, but it's sometimes obviously it's not as easy as I think it is, and I don't always get. I think I get the feel of it, so you can believe that it's the Doctor, if you can. So I mean, thank you. You're very kind. I never found it difficult. I just enjoy it. I like playing it. I think it's fun. It's quite hard though playing some of the other characters. I'm not familiar with it. Sorry,
the war machines were on.
I'm sure they were, but I wasn't on Blue Peter at that time. When you were saying before, you know, we used to run threads in Blue Peter from time to time where we'd have something about Doctor Who, and I suppose we had about six or seven in the 10 years I did the show. So, I mean, it's not a huge output, but it just always kept us in contact.
Yeah. And presented it from the Doctor Who set one time as well.
Well, we had to, yes, because there was a strike by the set builders at the BBC. In fact, I don't think we had any lights either that day. Right. We did it in sort of the studios, ordinary switch, and these sort of lights came on, and we were in the Doctor Who set because no one had moved their set out, now set in. Yeah. But there we go. Yeah.
Hey, one more question. I've got time for that. Sorry. What? Right, okay.
I was just wondering, Peter, if you watched the new series of Doctor Who, and how do you compare the new series to the classic series?
Nice question. I don't watch it on a regular, devoted way. I only watch it occasionally. I've seen Peter Capaldi. I think he's great. I loved Christopher Eccleston when it all came back and he was there. What I don't like about it is that I find the stories extremely complicated. I don't find them easy to follow. But that, I guess, is my age. I like a narrative that flows. And for me, the narrative doesn't flow. I mean, the great big massive production that was done for the 50th anniversary, which looked stunning. I mean, it was quite brilliant to look at. And I loved the experience of watching. I had no clue what was going on. I had no idea. I still don't. I liked the straightforward simplicity of the early years of telling a story in four parts, A to B, cliffhanger, pick it up, next one, cliffhanger, next one, and just keep it on like that. Nice and straightforward, simple stories, I hope told well. And for the money that we had at the time to make the show, I think they stand up remarkably well. But I think that technically the current stuff is fantastic, what I've seen of it. But I don't particularly like it because I can't follow it. I find it too complicated.
Yeah, you've got
someone my age back then. I'm 84.
What was your question?
The Dalek Master Plan was the first Doctor Who story to feature the death of two companions. What do you feel about that?
Yeah, the Dalek Master Plan. Yeah.
Yes, there were two companions who died, but they weren't real companions. One was, well, yes, they were. No, actually, that's not true. It was a hell of a surprise when we lost Katerina, because she'd been brought into the show at the end of the Mythmakers as the replacement for Vicky, who incidentally had no idea that she was being written out until we got the scripts of the Mythmakers. We come back from a summer break and we read the four scripts, and in episode four, Vicky leaves Doctor Who. She stays in Troy, presumably to die with all the other Trojans. I mean, hey, wait a minute, where did that come from? But then we get into the Mythmakers, into the Dalek Master Plan, where Katerina has taken over, and they decided straight away that a character from ancient Troy could not cope with the technology and the, where we were with Doctor Who and the way the stories would go. And so she was written out in episode 4, disappeared and she's dead. At the end of the at the end of episode 12, we lose Sarah Kingdom. Now Sarah was, I suppose she was an official companion in a similar vein to me, but she wasn't. She was a character that came in to tell the story. So she was incidental, very important, very incidental to the story, and became an apparent regular companion. But she wasn't free to continue with the series. They'd like to have kept her, I believe, but they couldn't keep her. She had other work to go to, and so she disappears in the pile of dust at the end. She's come back in Big Finish several times, so, which is great.
Wonderful.
And she's lovely. I love Gina Marsh. Yeah. But yes, I mean, it was strange. I had no idea until, in fact, if I remember rightly, we got episode 1 and 2 script for the show, and then we got, after we'd done episode 2, we got the script for episode 3, and after we'd done episode 3, we got the script for episode 4, and then episode 4, she'd gone. And I doubt if she knew she was going then. And the introduction of Adrienne Hill as the companion had been publicised quite strongly. You know, there was stuff in the press about it and all the rest of it. 4 episodes is all she did. Yeah, it was weird. So I felt it was weird in answer to your question. Yeah.
Peter, we could talk to you all night. You've done so much, but I'm afraid time's beaten us and we have to move on. Peter will be signing later, but please give a big round of applause to Peter Purves. Before we move on, we've got another auction item. So, put it on.